Hi, and thank you for worshiping with us. We're glad that you're with us today. We have several things that we want to bring to your attention before we get started in earnest. One of those is, you know, many of you hopefully have a mask, and if you don't, let the church office know. There are lots of people in our congregation, or several people in our congregation, making masks, and remember that the purpose of them isn't so much to protect you from other people who might have the virus. It actually is to help protect other people from you on the off chance that you might have it and don't know it. Remember, this virus likes to roll asymptomatic for a good while, for almost 2 weeks, before symptoms start showing up. And so you could inadvertently be spreading this around and not know it. And this is a way for you to help take personal responsibility for your community. So again, if you need one, call the church office and let us know, and we'll get in touch with the folks who've been kind enough to start making these for all of us. So make sure you're taking care of that. The other thing is, I want to say a special thank you to Mandy Ely. She not only is our CE, our Christian Education Director, she's not only specifically in charge of our youth program and children's programming and our adult education as a part of all the CE duties, but she also, if you will, is a big part of the creative arm of the team of folks who are putting these videos together, and she is responsible for the table setups. So I just want to say thank you to her in particular for that. That we do have a church-wide Bible study based on the letters of Paul that we've been engaged with for a while. We're continuing that. We're in phase three now. And that study, the study materials, the study guides are still available. You can get a copy of that from the church office. You can also get download a copy from our website, get details about it from our Facebook page. And as far as the study itself, people without a computer can participate because with it being a Zoom call, as long as you have a phone, you can study with us. You can get the details and you can call into the study, and several have done that. Details are available from the church office. There are two opportunities for this. One's at 2 p.m. and then the other's at 7:30 p.m. on Wednesdays. And pick one time, or you can come to both, but just pick one, whichever is convenient for you. The other thing that we want to say is that we are having fellowship time together as a church every Sunday afternoon at 4 o'clock. And again, thanks to our technology, our growing technology, we can bridge that distance of isolation whether or not you have a computer. So come and check in with your fellow church members using the available Zoom link and password, or call the number that's provided. Again, the details are available in the email that goes out each week. And also that gets mailed out each week to the congregation. Now, this coming Sunday, or on this Sunday, May 3rd at 4 p.m., we are having our trivia event, complete with prizes, so please do participate. We look forward to having you. With that, let us begin. Ephesians 2:22 says, Christ is building you into a place where God lives through the Spirit. Let us sing together.
Service is peoples binding humankind. Join hands, disciples of the faith, whatever your race may be. All children of the living God are surely kin to me. In Christ now meet both east and west, in him meet south and north. All Christly souls are one in him throughout the whole wide earth.
Let us pray together. Lord, you make us a house. We are, all of us, rooms, windows, and doors. We are spaces to get space and to gather. You set us up to be palaces, mansions without price and incomparable in design and construction. You make us to be places of greatness and hallways of amazing love and grace. Mercy is the mortar holding together the stones and bricks you use to establish us. And why? So that the address, your address, God, can be straightforward and easy to remember. It must break your heart when we forget. But it continues to be surprising to us that your desired address is us. You seek to reside in us. Thank you for your faith in us and with us. Thank you for seeing us and not rejecting us. Help us see everything the way you do. In the great name of Jesus Christ, we pray this together. Thank you for listening, God. Amen. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Let us sing together. You might design. us pray together. Lord, we celebrate your word written. By your Spirit, as we hear, help us understand that we might be your word embodied. Amen.
The scripture reading this morning is from Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 through 10, verses 19 through 22, and chapter 4, verses 1 through 6. Paul instructs the church on their responsibilities to each other. You are saved by God's grace because of your faith. The salvation is God's gift. It's not something you possessed. It's not something you did that you can be proud of. Instead, we are God's accomplishment, created in Christ Jesus to do good things. God planned for these good things to be the way that we live our lives. So now you are no longer strangers and aliens. Rather, you are fellow citizens with God's people, and you belong to God's household. As God's household, you are built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. The whole building is joined together in him, and it grows up into a temple that is dedicated to the Lord. Christ is building you into a place where God lives through the Spirit. Therefore, as a prisoner for the Lord, I encourage you to live as people worthy of the call you received from God. Conduct yourselves with all humility, gentleness, and patience. Accept each other with love and make an effort to preserve the unity of the Spirit with the peace that ties you together. You are one body and one Spirit, just as God also called you in one hope. There is one Lord, one faith, one baptism, and one God and Father of all, who is over all, through all, and in all. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The periodic table, the table of elements, right? I mean, it's a comprehensive view of our world, really. I mean, as we presently understand our planet, as we think about how pieces fit together, I mean, every compound, every strand of DNA, every molecule that's in the air or the oceans or the ground is made up of some combination of these elements. And it's one of the reasons why in sci-fi movies, they tend to make reference to something not being on the table as an indication that it is not from this world. And so it's our comprehensive view. And it is the genius of God's creation that things work this way. I mean, it's the reason that we're able to put together combinations of elements to solve all kinds of problems, or to correct errors that we cause, or to discover new ways to understand ourselves. Knowing chemistry is not just important for pharmacists and doctors or virologists, however. Knowing chemistry is important to understanding Paul's letter to the Ephesian church and the household of God that God is trying to set up with us and for us. So, put another way, we are elements of this periodic table, and it's the combination of us as elements, of us being that God's household, that God uses to effect good in this world and the next. We are God's achievement, the scripture says. And so, given all of this, and given how all of this is put together, it's interesting that Paul says, instead, we are God's accomplishment, created in Christ Jesus to do good things. God planned for these good things to be the way that we live our lives. So, what kind of award, then, should God receive for us? I mean, what kind of accolades or recognition should God receive for what's been done for us? I mean, we celebrate, right, that Jesus is risen in Easter, and we might even say that you might hear somebody say, I'm saved. But what does that mean? I mean, so what if Jesus is risen? What are we saved from? And more importantly, what are we saved for? Now, a cursory review of our history as a humanity since the cross, and you can see why some might find the idea that we, as a humanity, are much of an achievement, a dubious claim. I mean, it's not exactly a secret, right, that we have done horrible things as human beings and have continued to do so, even in the name of Christ, in the name of the church. There was the Inquisition, the Crusades. There were the missions, right? The missions to South America and Africa. There was the corruption of numerous church leaders. There was the Holocaust, which was done in the name of Hitler being named the head of the Lutheran Church in Germany. There was the promotion of slavery in the name of God and proper natural order. There's domestic violence victims being told to remain in danger by biblical mandate. Someone like Larry Nassar being permitted to abuse hundreds of victims before being stopped. Or that preacher in Virginia who told his congregation to ignore social distancing requirements of their state only to contract the virus himself and die from it. His wife is still sick. And there are the ways in which my own selfishness or short-sightedness, for instance, has not only not served my congregation well, but maybe even been harmful to some. I mean, these are but a few examples, right, of this humanity that is being called God's achievement. But I'm telling you, we are God's achievement. I mean, we aren't God's achievement because of what we've done. We're God's achievement because of what God has done. I mean, despite the innumerable ways that we try to be otherwise, God makes a way for us to be better humans, better people. It's a way of understanding who we are that both takes the pressure off, but also raises our standards. I mean, salvation is not something that we accomplish. It's who we are. That's why Jesus is risen. And that's why salvation isn't a momentary event by rare, painstaking event thing that flares up every now and then. And it isn't something that just happens later after we die. Salvation is a way of life. So we should and must acknowledge what should and must change in us. We should acknowledge what we've done wrong and where we have not just misstepped, but brought harm. And we also must acknowledge what has changed in us and what has been achieved. You see, God has done remarkably good things in us, in all of us. And no confession is complete unless we can acknowledge all of that. Now, pause the video and for the moment, think, talk about your good qualities. What is good about you? And what are some good things that you do? What about you makes you glad? Chances are, it makes God glad also. So Paul writes, so now you are no longer strangers and aliens. Rather, you are fellow citizens with God's people, and you belong to God's household. Christ is building you into a place where God lives through the Spirit. That's great. It's aspirational. And yet, given our current political climate, it can be easy to get caught up with Paul's language here in chapter 2. I mean, the talk about being citizens versus being strangers and aliens can devolve into an argument about immigration policy, for example, in our country. While there's a time and a place for that debate, and believe me, the Bible has a lot to say about it directly from cover to cover, we need to be keen about what Paul is saying here and to not get baited into taking verses out of context. In this context, what is Paul saying? Well, remember, for Paul, being a stranger or an alien, this was language right out of the Torah, the first five books of the Bible. And that meant being outside the fold of the family of God. It meant being Gentile. The Ephesians were no longer on the outside of what God is trying to do. And neither are we. But Paul goes further and says that they are citizens. They aren't just born into the fold. They have rights and they've got privileges. It's an understanding, right, that's born out of being connected to being a Roman citizen himself, and how that served God's purposes in Paul's own life and saved his neck, I might add. Only Paul's here not talking about being a Roman citizen in terms of Roman politics. Paul is talking about fundamental human identity. And so, fundamentally, the Ephesians belong to God's household. And so do we. But unlike the immigration or citizen debate, this is not a statement about where we live. If verse 22 is any indication, it's about where God lives. The achievement, God's achievement, is this. While we demonstrate historically, time and time again, what we can do, what we're capable of apart from God's Spirit, it's wondrous what we can do when God's Spirit resides with us. When God's Spirit chooses to reside even with us. God has chosen us as God's address. And so Paul writes, "And make an effort to preserve the unity of the Spirit with the peace that ties you together. You are one body and one spirit, just as God also called you into one hope." Unity. So, how do we show ourselves to be that achievement? How do we live the life of salvation? I mean, how do we bear out that focus, especially now? Well, remember how this all starts. It doesn't start with you. It starts with God. I mean, just as we are all God's creation and design, we are all also God's objects and subjects of care. I mean, God doesn't delegate our growth or our home improvement to another contractor or construction company. God is hands-on, doing all the work God's own self. That means that we need to be open to what God means to show us, to do with us, to shape us, to renovate and innovate in us, how God tries to inspire us. Also, imagine, right, if the whole periodic table were only one element. There could be no earth. There could be no medical breakthroughs or plastic or computers or disease-resistant food or rocket ships or even water purification. I mean, without all of us intentionally at the table that God designs, we fall short of God's plans for an imaginative, innovative future as a church and as a people. We need each other in a fundamental, elemental way. And we need to act as though we know this. And so this means we need humility before the mutuality God has set up in us. God has arranged it so that we would be together God's house. Our being together should be to God's advantage. And like us, God is looking for a good home, a stable home, a priceless home. A home that can withstand the weather, the tests of time, and to become a place of memories and history and comfort. This is what must be, what we must be for one another, for God's sake. We are God's address. And so God doesn't bring us together just to see what happens. God brings us together in order to make mutual blessings happen, to make the life of faith and salvation happen, and to make us into the house where God's own Spirit resides. Thanks be to God that this is so. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Let us sing together. And let me invite all the men to sing on the first verse, women to sing on the second verse, and for everyone to sing on the third verse, and for everybody to be singing the chorus all the way through.
Men of faith, rise up and sing of our great and glorious King. You are strong when you feel weak, in your brokenness complete. Shout to the north and the south, sing to the east and the west. Jesus is Savior to all, Lord of heaven and earth.
Rise up, women of the truth, stand and sing to broken hearts. Who can know the healing power of our awesome King of love?
Shout to the north and the south, sing to the east and the west. Jesus is Savior to all, Lord of heaven and earth. We've been through fire, we've been through rain, we've been refined by the power of your name. We've fallen deeper in love with you, you've burned this truth on our lips. Shout to the north and the south, sing to the east and the west, Jesus is Savior to all, Lord of heaven and earth. Rise up, church, with broken wings, fill this place with songs again of our God who reigns on high. By God's grace again we'll fly. Shout to the north and the south, sing to the east and the west. Jesus is Savior to all, Lord of heaven and earth. He is Lord of heaven and earth.
So we don't give because God's impressed with our generosity. No one is outgiving God. Our tithes, gifts, participation, our acts of service and compassion, our offerings should all be given cheerfully out of thanks for what God has made us, the household of God. And so at the end of the video, there are going to be lots of suggestions made for ways to give. So stick around and do what you're called to do as God's house.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Submit. submission, all is at rest. I and my Savior am happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior.
Together. Lord, take our gifts offered in earnest. Multiply them according to your purposes, that they may serve your ends, and in the process, make us all a part of the blessing you mean for the world. Amen.
God invites us to the table God prepares. It's not because God must do this, it's because God chooses to do this. It's because God maintains hope that we will become the people of God's dreams. Let us pray. Lord God, you do not give up on us. Despite what we did in the garden, you made us clothes and taught us to farm. Despite how we complained in the desert, you sent us manna and entrusted your heart to us. Despite us rejecting your leadership for one corrupt king after another, you promised to be our king anyway. And despite what we saw, what we heard, what we felt, we killed Jesus. You still choose us, God, and this table is proof. So bless these common elements for their uncommon purpose, that they may be for us a reminder of the body and the blood, and of your boundless mercy toward us. We thank you for your grace and for what you still teach us, even how to pray, saying, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
And so on the night in which he was betrayed, Jesus took the bread and after blessing it, he broke it, gave it to his disciples and said, Take and eat. This is my body given for you. As often as you eat of it, do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he took the cup, and after pouring it out, he blessed it, gave it to his disciples, and said, This cup is the new covenant, sealed by my blood for the forgiveness of many. All of you drink of it. For as often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's saving death until he comes. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. The only proper response to God's grace is gratitude. So let us pray together. Thank you, God, for making us your home. Help us live out that thanks by being home to all you call to us. Thank you for including us at your table. Help us do the same with ours. In the great name of Jesus Christ, we pray this together. Amen. Let us sing together.
We have raised our hope. And we stumbled over the trials of life, and we wrestled the unseen. But only one calmed the storm inside our soul. In the hands of God, we will fall, fall, fall. Rest for the restless and the weary, hope for the sinner. In the hands of God, we stand tall, tall, tall. And set a mighty to deliver, giving gave way to the weight of guilt, till we shrink for every breath. Only one can lift our shame and make us well. And when all is finished and we face the fearsome power of death, only one has overcome the gates of hell. Of God, we will fall, fall, fall. Rest for the restless and the weary, hope for the sinner. In the hands of God, we stand tall, tall, tall. And set a mighty to deliver, giving freedom.
Together our benediction. God doesn't bring us together just to see what happens. God brings us together to make mutual blessings happen, to make the life of faith and salvation happen, and to make us into the house where God's own Spirit resides. So get up and take heart. Jesus is still calling you. Be at peace. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah. So as was said earlier, there are a lot of ways to give, right? And there are a lot of ways to give that don't involve money. You could send cards or write letters. You could park in someone's driveway and pray with them over the phone. You can visit with folks through the window of their house or residence. You could collect right? Non-perishable food to give to Manna Market, to give to our schools, or to give to a neighbor that you know about. You could determine to share your tithe or part or all of your stimulus check. You could call or FaceTime random or particular people in your contacts or directory. You could pray every day for our prayer list, for your own list, or both. You could pray for yourself, yes, yourself, to be shaped into what God wants you to be. You could determine that being a part of the household of God doesn't limit your options, but actually expands your options for love and compassion and kindness. Be generous, because that's what we as a household of God are called to be. Now look, if you have means and will and inclination to give money to the church, you can do so. And you can bring your offering or gift by the church office. You can still submit it online by making the church a vendor with your bank's bill pay service. Or you could go to our church's website and give through our Square portal. There's no extra app or software that you need, just your browser. You could also mail a check, but please don't mail cash. And you certainly can call the church office and we'll walk you through the process. You can set time aside or schedule when you will do some of the things prescribed in the meditation. But whatever you do, again, be generous.